At just 18 months, Kathleen Folbigg witnessed the stabbing murder of her mother at the hands of her father. Then between 1989 and 1999, Kathleen and husband Craig lost four children, Caleb, Patrick, Sarah, and Laura, before their second birthdays. Tragedy seemed to haunt Kathleen, but when Craig found her diary containing chilling entries,
"I am my father's daughter."
That family tragedy became a murder trial.
Did you kill Caleb?
No!
Did you kill Patrick?
No!
Did you kill Sarah?
No.
Did you kill Laura?
No.
The evidence against Kathleen was largely circumstantial, but the loss of all four children to natural causes was deemed to be beyond a coincidence. Folbigg was convicted of killing her children.
She is adamant that she didn't commit these offences, and 25 years is a long time if you're not guilty of an offence.
Folbigg always maintained her innocence and claimed those damning diary entries had been badly misunderstood.
"I knew I was short-tempered and cruel sometimes to her, and she left with a bit of help."
"It was a reference to God or to some higher being or a higher power. I was so just desperate for an answer as to why they left me."
Last year, Aussie scientists believe they uncovered those answers.
Sarah and Laura, they both carried a variant or a mutation. Now, this mutation was inherited from Kathleen.
That mutation can cause cardiac arrhythmia and unexpected death, while a different, dangerous mutation was found in the boys.
What we found is that both male children carried a mutation in a gene that, when deleted in mice, causes early-onset severe lethal epilepsy.
Today, 90 eminent Australian scientists petitioned the New South Wales governor seeking a pardon for Kathleen Folbigg.
If she is successful, that does not mean her convictions are quashed. It means that she will be freed from prison.
Tracy Chapman never stopped believing and fighting for her friend.
"I've known her for a very long time, since we were 5 or 6 years old. I know her well. The person I know could never have done that."
But fresh scientific evidence has already failed once before, with the 2019 inquiry reinforcing Folbigg's guilt.
"This is really strong evidence from some of the world's best scientists, and I think the petition signatories are a testament to the strength of this new evidence."
"The truth never lies. It doesn't. It just takes a lot longer to surface. We all care about her and we want to bring her home. So we won't stop."
Well, Professor Joseph Gex is a paediatric geneticist and a signatory to the petition, and he joins us now. Professor, what do you believe happened to Craig and Kathleen Folbigg's four children?
As somebody who has watched this case now for a little bit of time, I believe we are dealing with a very unfortunate situation where natural causes of death of the children of this couple were interpreted as non-natural.
So, Professor, some of this evidence was submitted to the inquiry in 2019. The former judge, who was the head of that inquiry at the time, Reginald Blanche, seemed unmoved by this evidence. How strong and how much has changed since 2019 to make this a more compelling proposition now?
We are really miles away almost every year at the moment. And the major piece of evidence for at least the two girls of this couple to have a genetic predisposition which very plausibly, highly likely, explain their early death.
The mutations that you found in the DNA, the genetic history of the girls, how common is that? How widely spread is that through society?
There is a register of similar cases of sudden infant death or changes in these genes internationally, where there are 75 cases like that. But there is no other case of a healthy individual with a variant like found in these children, apart from their mother, because their mother also has this genetic predisposition, in the world so far.
So, Professor, does the law need to catch up with science in this case?
Yes, exactly. That's part of the message as well, that the science is changing so quickly and we're learning so much that in a family like this of Kathleen and Craig, it was implausible to speculate that they would have died of natural causes. But now we have compelling evidence that the two girls have very serious genetic risk. And the boys, while they don't have the same genetic risk as the girls, it looks like they may have a different risk.
So as we talk to you tonight, are you satisfied in your own mind that there is a woman sitting in jail, who's been sitting in jail now for many years, who simply should not be there, who was innocent?
Based on scientific evidence and my conviction of the results presented by the team, yes.
The idea that a woman has been sitting in jail unfairly for 18 years is unthinkable, but let's hope that the authorities do look at this petition and take it very seriously. Thanks for your time, Professor.
It was my pleasure. Thank you very much.
And as far as we understand it, if the petition fails, she's due for a non-parole period of 25 years, so she's still got about another 7 years in jail before she has any hope of release if the petition doesn't work.
So is it true that she was convicted on circumstantial evidence? So at the time there was no physical evidence that she was guilty, but they took all of this information from her diaries, which to me is very disturbing. She's a traumatised woman who's writing in a diary at a time when she's lost children, she's possibly already got mental health issues because she's grown up, you know, under the shadow of her mother's murder. It just doesn't seem like it's the sort of place where you're looking for evidence in a diary.
Yeah, well, it's convinced courts up till now. Guess we wait and see.
From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.